following contains an opinion on the internet. Viewer discretion is advised. Put on your anti-opinion sound mufflers and flip to page 43 of this book is a safe space. Now that we are ready to see an opinion on the internet, let us proceed.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am live with the To Be Continued podcast. Let's get the call going with Rick. Hello.
Hello.
All right. So I don't know if you can see the stream, but I'm experimenting with something new today. Instead of capturing the Discord chat window between us, I'm trying to rig up your your character here to move when you talk. If I've done this right.
All right. Am I moving yet?
You're moving when I'm talking, but. Apparently you're not moving when you're talking. So I'm gonna adjust the mic sensitivity delay. Okay, and if this doesn't work, we'll figure things out later. This whole podcast was really built on an experiment, wasn't it?
God, pretty much.
All right. Well, it's not doing anything, but let's just keep going.
Okay.
So, what do you got for this week?
Well, not much. Actually, there's the second half of my vacation. I could talk briefly about that. I know we were doing the show last week while I was over there. Before I left, I did a bus tour of LA. We went to some of the big places where I did, like, Hollywood stuff. That was kind of fun. Then we stopped to eat at a local restaurant. And then we came home right after, so not much after that. I also beat Infernax.
Oh, nice. How was it?
It was great. I got the ultimate good ending, which is one of the best endings in the game. And man, it was a blast. Like, the final boss was, like, so crazy. I used, like, all my spells, and then it ended with this really cool cutscene of me killing a monster. Man, it was great. It was a blast. Right now, I'm playing through it again, but this time I like the evil route, and I'm nearly halfway there as well, so it'll be interesting to see how that one compares to the ultimate good ending.
Yeah, I love when games have alignment-based endings that aren't defined by a single solitary choice or really, like, obvious choices, but instead subtle ones that you make throughout the entirety of your gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
I've started a new game this week, and I was actually playing it last night with Rinny and some of her friends on her server. I started up Demonologist, and holy crap, that game is terrifying. That was the first game in a very long time that made me afraid as an adult. I think the last game that did that was Dementium the Ward, and I played that back in, like, what, 2017?
Wow, I was still in high school when that game came out.
Well, Dementium the Ward came out earlier than that. That was just when I played it. Dementium was a game released for the Nintendo DS. So 2017, the DS had long since retired. They were doing 3DS by that point.
Mm-hmm.
But Demonologist is freaking crazy. You get spooks that are based on that are in response to stuff that you and your friends talk about via voice chat in that. One of the funniest things that happened last night is I got the box to talk to the ghost, and I decided to ask the ghost, "Are you an asshole?" And immediately it starts knocking books off the shelves and knocking vases over.
Wow, I guess the answer is a yes then.
Yeah, no, we were laughing about that, because supposedly the questions that you can ask the ghost are the same that you would be asking in Phasmophobia. Like, you know, there's certain questions that you can ask that will get responses, other ones won't really be recognized. And the fact that that worked is just mind-boggling. Eventually we were trying to hunt the thing that separates Demonologist from Phasmophobia, aside from the tech in it and how it listens to your conversations, is that if you don't guess the ghost correctly, it doesn't matter if you survive or how much evidence you collect. If you guess wrong, you get no payout for that run. And you need money to buy your ghost hunting equipment.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, thankfully, there is some basic equipment you start out with that you can't lose, but geez, that is punishing. I think we died or we lost each round, or no, one round we ended up all dying, one round, or no, and then like three more rounds, we were completely off base. There was one where we got very, very close, but we misread some of the evidence and guessed wrong. And then eventually we started getting it right. And eventually we got so used to the spooks at that one location, because it seems that there's some spooks that are randomly generated and others that are dependent on the location. So we got kind of acclimated to the spooky atmosphere, and that's when the shit posting started. I started trash talking the ghost by the voice box, and it's telling your mama jokes and stupid shit like that. It was a blast playing Demonologist last night.
Oh, is that game made by the Fast Road team, or is it just a different team?
I think it was made by a different team. I'm not 100% on that. It's very similar to Phasmo, though. So it makes me wonder if, like, it started out as a mod for Phasmo and then became its own thing. I do know that Demonologist was more recent, because I think it came out like this year.
Oh.
If not this year, then very, very late last year. I actually don't own Phasmophobia. I've never even played it. The only experience I have with Phasmophobia is watching Micah's occasional streams of it. I was actually joking about how Micah sexually harassed a ghost one time in Demonologist last night, or in Phasmo when I was playing Demonologist with the others last night. I was half tempted to start to do that myself, but I didn't. And then I'm really looking forward to the event we've got planned Tuesday. Because I'm not sure if you got a chance to watch the first episode, but the first episode of the Dragon Quest 9 Let's Play is up on YouTube now, and that was a complete pain to edit until I realized that the emulator had an auto swap screen function. That feature saved the entire run, believe it or not.
Well, that's nice. I'm glad to see you're able to salvage the recording.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Because without that, I would have had to have manually spliced the footage. So, because what I was... The stupid thing about Dragon Quest IX, and this is less stupid when playing on original hardware, but if you're playing on other hardware, what happens is the main screen for overworld cutscenes and overworld navigation is the bottom screen. And then on the top screen is a map. But when you go into battle, the bottom screen becomes your battle menu, and the top screen shows your characters fighting the enemies.
Well, that's really annoying. I think it would make more sense if, like, they just kept that consistent.
I know, it's baffling as to why they did that. I guess because this was the DS, I'm trying to remember, when did it come out in the DS's life cycle? Dragon Quest released date. Okay, so it came out in 2010 in the US. Okay, that's weird. That's actually really weird. If this were the early DS lifecycle, I'd understand. But by this point, most developers were using the DS's two screen function, as one is a map or a menu, and the other is your gameplay, and it was pretty consistent. I have no idea what happened here.
Maybe they just want to go a different direction.
Yeah, I guess so. And then, what else happened this week? I'm trying to think. Oh, I finished Deus Ex and finally uploaded all of it to YouTube.
Woohoo!
Yeah. I got lazy with the editing in the final episode, though, because that was a 4-hour stream that I broke down into parts. But then there's 3 endings to that game. I gave 2 of the endings their own like full length episode, but the third ending where you plunge the world into a new dark age, I'm just like, yeah, no, you get 4 minutes. I hate this ending so that much, and I was just so burned out by the editing at that point, because I think it took me a grand total of like 2 days to edit all of that.
Oh yeah, I can imagine being a lot of work.
Yeah. You seen any new movies or read any new books since last weekend?
Haven't seen or read anything new per se. Although I do had a Curse of the Gov engine earlier. Because I know when the Dragon Quest games did not release out of Japan. I thought it was 9, it was actually 10.
Oh really?
Yeah, Dragon Quest X is actually, in fact, outside of a discontinued Windows version in Chinese, Dragon Quest has never been released outside Japan.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
If that's the only mainline title with this distinction.
That's weird. I wonder why they did that.
Well, it is an MMORPG, so maybe they just didn't have the resources to have it work outside. Yeah, I think it's the only MMORPG in the series. Because I know with Final Fantasy, they had 2 of them. They had 11 and they had 14. 10 has been the only one for Dragon Quest, so maybe they didn't have the resources to localize the game outside Japan, or maybe they just chose not to. I know with Dragon Quest in particular, most of the games are actually done, at least on Nintendo Power, it's done by Nintendo, although Square has done a couple of them in the past.
Yeah, Square was actually the one behind Dragon Quest IX's development.
Oh yeah, I think you're right about that.
Yeah, because when I was, I'm a nerd. When I see cool cinematics in a game, I tend to watch them. And I was watching the intro when I was doing the first episode of the Dragon Quest Let's Play, and I noticed that it was a Square game. And I'm like, what? Square Enix was involved with this?
Yeah, because that comes more so the Enix side of the company. Because before Square Enix, there was SquareSoft and there was Enix. And then in the early 2000s, they merged to become Square Enix.
Right. And that's part of the reason that we don't have a remake of Super Mario RPG. Because the paperwork behind that would be an absolute nightmare to sort out.
Yeah, I would imagine the virtual work got lost post-merger.
Yeah. It's kind of frustrating when companies do mergers and then IPs get lost because it's not clear who owns the rights to what. Especially when when the IPs are held by a Nintendo that is held by a company that is notorious for litigation like Nintendo.
Yeah, actually, Geo's only real appearance outside of Smash was in Mario Luigi RPG. Superstar Saga, the original specifically, because in the remake they took him out.
Yeah. I always wondered why they took him out in the remake. That is such a small appearance that it makes zero sense for them to have taken him out.
The only reason I can think of is that Nintendo's the rights to the character. That's the only reason I can think of. Because his only 2 other appearances is a skin in Smash 4 and Ultimate, and both of those were after they started working with Square Enix. So...
Wait, he was a skin in Smash 4?
Yeah, he was a Mii Fighter costume. Mii Gunner, specifically.
I had no idea about that.
Yeah, it was that one, and they brought it back for a refined version for Ultimate. Also as DLC. In both cases, it was a paid costume you had to pay for.
Yeah.
So, it wasn't even free.
Man, you want to talk about missed potential, the fucking Smash roster... I don't know what brought this into my brain today, but this morning when I was playing my Game Boy, I'm just sitting here thinking to myself, man, there's so many characters that should be in Smash that aren't. Rayman, Waluigi, Isaac from Golden Sun, Geno, just to name a few.
Well, the problem with a couple you mentioned is like outside of Waluigi. See, one of the factors that about whether or not carrying into Smash Brothers is whether or not they have a future in like the games and like their series. And like, if they're from a character, like they're from a game that hasn't had a new installment in a while, like a Golden Sun, for example, their odds of getting in are actually much, much lower as a fighter compared to like a character who's like constantly getting new games or showing up in new installments.
Right, because because Smash Bros. Has kind of become promotional bait, which is really unfortunate.
I mean, if you think about it, well, the series originally started as just a celebration of Nintendo gaming, and then it started branching out to third parties. It kind of started Brawl, but like, Brawl already still has the original spirit sense. I think Ultimate is really the one where like it starts to move away from like just... It's still an all-star fighter, but I think it's more so when they just started like putting a bigger emphasis on newer titles compared to older ones. I think, well, that's also true Smash Bros. As well. At least with the base roster, I think they did a better job of putting more fan favorites, because a lot of the newcomers' base game were determined by the Smash ballot, and a lot of legacy characters got a lot of support. So the ones that Nintendo fully owned, they were able to get those in fairly easily. It was just a matter of just getting them to work.
Right. That said, it still baffles me why they did Piranha Plant and not Waluigi. That's just... why?
I don't know. Maybe he's just the eternal understudy, more so than Luigi.
It must be. I mean, to be fair, Waluigi has only shown up in spin-off titles, but at the same time, Waluigi has only shown up in spin-off titles. What the fuck? Smash is the ultimate spin-off title.
You know what's interesting, though? Every single Mario character that's playable in Smash has appeared in at least one mainline title in the series. Even Daisy showed up in Mario Land. Wario made his debut as the villain in Mario Land 2. So even those two have debuted in the main series. And that's something interesting I noticed, like, when you look at all the characters. It's like none of those characters debuted in a spinoff game or from a spinoff series. I just find it really fascinating how that was the case.
That's a good point. That's actually a really good point.
The only exception to the rule I can think of is like Dr. Mario, but even then, it's just Mario in a doctor's suit. That's not really that different of a character.
Right.
So maybe it's some kind of thing where like they try to focus on characters who actually appear in the main series, because they're probably the most recognizable, or they're easier to pick out in a crowd. In fact, one of the reasons Piranha Plant was chosen was because of how recognizable he was of like the Mario enemies, while also having a surprisingly in-depth moveset potential in a way that nobody really expected, outside of Sakurai to see him, of course. Pretty creative fellows over there.
I guess. I will forever be salty about Piranha Plant. Cause it's dumb. It's like really dumb.
I don't know, I kind of liked him when he came out, just because of how different and unorthodox he was. The other character is actually a heavyweight.
What?
Yeah, he's actually one of the heaviest characters in the game. By weight class.
Why? How?
Maybe it's the pot. Or is it a pipe? I'm not really sure.
Kind of a mix of the two, huh?
Yeah, because some alts have him with a pot, others have him with a pipe. And yeah. So... it's hard to tell.
I'm also kind of bummed out that we never got any other Sonic characters into the game.
Yeah, the only series that got a new character that wasn't a clone was Final Fantasy.
And wait, what?
Yep. The only series in Smash Bros. That's a third-party series that got more than one rep, in which the second rep is not a clone of the first rep, is Final Fantasy.
I was for a moment there, I'm like, wait, who's in the game from Final Fantasy? And then I remembered, oh yeah, it's Sephiroth and Cloud.
Bro, how do you forget that?
Because I never played Final Fantasy VII. I have played Final Fantasy 1 through 4. I've completed 1 and 2 on the Dawn of Souls Game Boy Advance cartridge. And by the way, don't ever play 2. I was hating myself every second of that game the more I played it.
It's boring.
it's awful. I'm going to be playing 3, probably on stream because of the Pixel remaster, and now we have a version of 3 that is visually consistent with the rest of the series that I've played through. I've played 4 about halfway through. I love 4. I love its story, but I got lost. I did not know where to go next, and I just kept fucking around, and I'm like, well, I'm not going anywhere. I'm gonna play something else, and then I just never got back to it. Hopefully I will, you know what, I might do, like, all the Final Fantasy games except 2 for a stream or a marathon of some sort.
All the Final Fantasies, not 2, though. We don't talk about you.
Or 7. Because that was when the series lost me. I like 1 through 6, excluding 2. I mean, to an extent, I like 2 because it's a game that we didn't originally get when they were first coming out. But aside from that appeal, oh god, there is a reason this did not get localized for a long time. But 3, 4, and 5, and 6 are fucking incredible. 1, I have actually beaten 1 the most, though. I think I've played through that game, like, 3 times in all. Me and my dad were actually talking about Final Fantasy some months back, and apparently he has only ever played the NES version of 1. And that's surprising that he completed that, because I hear that the NES version is incredibly buggy.
Well, that's true of a couple NES teams back in the day.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, it was also fairly early on, so there's only so much they could do. I mean, you can only go up from there. And the Virtual was still a massive hit in spite of its flaws.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It saved the entire company.
Mm-hmm.
You know what just occurred to me? People don't really talk about Final Fantasy 8 or 9. People talk about 7, 10... Well, okay, people meme on Leon Squall and the absolute, like, lack of character he has in 8, but nobody talks about 9, which is weird.
Well, 9 is actually designed to be a return of form to the series because it was the last single-numbered entry in the series. I actually want to know your thoughts on 9 because the team who made 9 made it more like the old-school Final Fantasy games before 7 and 8.
Yeah, I've seen footage of it. I have yet to play it, but it looks like something I might play. I might do it.
I think you might actually like it.
Because
if you like the older Final Fantasy games, you'll probably like 9. Because 9 was made for, like, old-school Final Fantasy fans.
Right, and so I probably will enjoy it when I do play it. I'm not playing 10 or 11 or 12, though. Fuck that.
What's wrong with 10?
Isn't that the one with Tidus?
What's wrong with Tidus?
That stupid-ass laugh. That is all the reason I need.
That was one cutscene.
I know.
Okay, well, I don't fault you for not playing 11, because 11's an MMORPG that's technically not even out anymore, so I don't even know if there's a way to even play that one. But,
Oh, that's right, because 11 ended up becoming 14 because it was such a flop. I always forget about that detail.
Actually, no. 14 was a separate entity altogether. It is the second MMORPG, but it's not a continuation of 11. 11 was its own beast, and 11, I think, did fairly well for its time. But 14, the original version of 14, that's the one that flopped. Then they essentially remade it with, like, A Realm Reborn. And that's the one that got where they actually destroyed the old world and made a new one.
Oh.
Because the original 14 was... Because 11 was actually a really, really good game. But 14, the original 14, was so bad, the developers publicly apologized for making a shit game, and they made a better one with The Realm Reborn, and that's been thriving ever since.
Oh, wow. So it's cool that they were able to salvage that.
Oh, well, granted, they had to reboot the entire universe, but they made it work.
And then was 13 that one with the dudes in the car?
No, that was 15. 13 was the one with Lightning. And they made a whole trilogy out of those games.
Oh, wait, I thought Lightning was in 11.
No, Lightning was in 13. 11 was the first MMORPG that Square Enix did.
You know what's weird? I vaguely recall, like, I recall 11 being, like, hyped up when it came out. And I have, other than that, I have no recollection of what it was like, of anything about it. I just remember there being hype.
Well, 11 was part of, like, the trinity of Final Fantasy games that was announced at, like, Space World 2000. It was Final Fantasy IX, which came out that same year. there was Final Fantasy X, which came on the PS2 the year after. It was actually launched over PS2, and then 11 came out the year after that. So that was part of the whole trinity of games. 12 is actually set in the same world as Final Fantasy Tactics.
Oh, that's the one with the isekai, right? Where they get sent to another world.
I think. I don't know much about 12 other than the fact that it takes place in the same universe as Tactics. In fact, it actually takes place in the same universe as Tactics, so the events of Tactics are canon to 12.
But right, Tactics...
I think it takes place like after that.
Wait, is Tactics a different game from Tactics Advance, or was that just a remake?
I think Tactics Advance is actually a sequel to the original Tactics, and then 12 takes place after Advance.
Oh, okay. Tactics Advance, I played like the first 15 minutes of, and anyone who has played that game will know that, will get the joke there. That cutscene goes on for fucking ever. I like story in a game, but I was promised a video game, not a movie.
Speaking of movies, do you remember that one Final Fantasy movie they did back in the day?
I know it exists because I've heard people talk about it. I think it's Advent Children, right?
No, that was their second movie. That was actually, people like that one a lot more. The first one was called Final Fantasy The Spirits Within.
Okay, I have never heard of that one.
Well, I see why, because basically, the only thing of Final Fantasy about it was the fact that it was called Final Fantasy. It was some weird, like, spirit thing. It wasn't based on any game in the series. Aside from a chocobo or two, there was no ties to any games. It would just feel like a generic film, and it flopped. It was supposed to be the first in a line of movies by Square Films. They made a whole film division at Square. And the failure of that movie and the bankruptcy of Square Films is actually part of the reason Square merged with Enix in the first place.
Wow.
Yup.
So I take it this thing has about as much to do with Final Fantasy as the 90s version of the Mario movie had to do with Mario.
Pretty much. This is during a time when video game movies were notoriously terrible still.
Yeah.
Like, the fact that we're only now getting good video game movies just shows, like, how far we've come as an society. Because people for a long time were like, you can't adapt a video game because it doesn't work out. And then with both Sonic and Mario, they showed us that no, it can work when you get the right people and you have the right things planned out.
And you respect the source material.
Of course.
I think part of the reason for the shift is that the video game industry has gone from this niche market that's considered for kids or as a hobbyist thing to a billion-dollar industry that is outclassing the movie industry.
And we've been outclassing the movie industry for over a decade now.
Really? Has it been that long?
Yeah. Movies, video games as a whole started outgrossing movies around the time Grand Theft Auto 5 came out.
Wow, you know what's funny? I was about to say Grand Theft Auto 5 wasn't that long ago, but then I realized, wait, that was like, what, 2009?
13.
2013, okay, so my senior year of high school. Holy fuck, that was 10 years ago. What the fuck?
I think it was, like, starting high school that year, actually.
Okay, better question. How has it been 10 years and no new Grand Theft Auto? I unironically like the ONL Mario movie. That might be my nostalgia glasses, though. You know, Lazy Gaming, I actually like that movie, too. I got the VHS of it as a birthday present from my mom, and I watched that thing way more times than I would care to admit. It was my favorite movie as a kid. As an adult, I still like it, not nearly as much, but it's definitely a guilty pleasure.
Oh yeah, same here. And I saw the movie way after it came out, because, like, you know, I was born after it released, and I actually got a DVD at Target when I was in, like, late elementary school, and my sister and I just watched it. We just had a blast. We knew it was definitely a far cry from the games, but we just watched it for ha-has. It wasn't anything, like, deeper than that, I would say.
Oh yeah,
but we had our fun with it.
The cheese definitely carries that movie.
Yeah. Do you know that, like, Bob Hoskins and, what's this guy play Luigi? They were, like, drunk the entire time.
Oh, yeah. I heard about that. Have you seen the Gaming Historian's, documentary on that movie?
I have not.
He goes into detail not just on the movie's history, but also how it was made and all the crazy shit that happened during production. Lazy Gaming says, "Yeah, now it falls into so bad it's good." Yeah, that's where it's at for me. When I was a child who didn't have any taste, I unironically enjoyed it. Me and my friend even mimicked the sort of weird handshake Mario and Luigi do in that movie. Now as an adult, I'm like, I can only enjoy this ironically.
Remember to see when Mario was dancing with Birdo and he was trying to get the stone from her neck?
That was Big Bertha, I think, not Birdo.
Oh,
Yeah, you'd think it would be Birdo, because dinosaurs and all that, but no, that was Big Bertha. Yeah, the giant fish enemy from Mario 3.
I don't know
what they were smoking either. Probably crack.
Yeah, I could see why Nintendo was... See, that and the failure of the film CDI games is why Nintendo was so protective of their IP for the longest time. Because I think back then they knew they couldn't trust anyone to handle them properly. Because, like, the people at the time were probably just doing it to make money. They didn't really care about the source material. And that's true of a lot of video game adaptations as well.
Did you know that the couple that were the producers or directors, I can't remember which, they might have filled both roles, actually, for the Mario movie, were the same people that did Rain Man?
What do you mean by Rain Man?
Rain Man. It was a movie about this guy who is, like, really, really, really good at math, but has, like, social issues.
Oh. How would you know that?
Because my mom watched that movie when I was younger, and some people compare people with autism to Rain Man, be that in a favorable or unfavorable way. I never really seen it in the movie, so I wouldn't know. I've only heard about it secondhand.
I thought she was supposed to be a
thwomp. Yeah, see, that just goes to show you how shit the costume and enemy inspiration was in that movie.
Okay, not even get me started on the Goombas.
Actually, you know what? I actually believe the Goombas were the most... the old term was idiot savant, yeah. But no, the Goombas were actually the one thing that was kind of close. I mean, they don't look like the mushroom versions, but if you've played Super Mario World... Which that was the Mario game that I played the most extensively as a kid. The Goombas in that game are round, so I think that's where they got the Goomba design from.
Well, technically, the guys in Mario World you refer to are not Goombas. They're actually a different enemy called Galoombas.
Are you sure?
No. Yeah, I know because in the credits it says Galoomba in the credits, and also I did my research and they're actually a separate. They're a cousin of the Goomba. They're similar, but they're not exactly the same. You could tell because with the Goombas, you stop and you kill them instantly. Whereas as with the Galoombas, you simply like knock them over and you can pick them up and stuff.
Oh, you're right. All this time, I just thought they were a weird variant of the Goombas.
I mean, typically they are. They're just not called Goombas.
The more you know.
Hey.
But, Hey, you ever notice how the Sarlacc pit in the special edition of Star Wars looks like a piranha plant that came off the set of the Mario movie?
You know, I never thought of it that way.
When I first saw the special edition of Star Wars, that was my immediate thought. I'm like, damn it, George, put the piranha plant back. It was fine without that.
You know what's funny? Of all the movies in the original trilogy, Return of the Jedi was the one that was like changed the most in the special edition.
Yeah, Empire, I noticed.
Yeah, Empire was changed the least, actually. Like, most of what they did was just, like, slight background changes. I think the biggest change they made was to the Cloud City, where they just added more dynamic backgrounds, and that was basically it.
Well, there was one other thing. In some cuts of the... of Empire Strikes Back, Luke's scream as he jumps down... is replaced with the scream of Emperor Palpatine as he's thrown down the pit. I don't know why that edit exists, but I distinctly remember that because I was watching the special editions at a friend's house one night, and I'm like, that sound is not supposed to be there.
Yeah, I think that was in the VHS release, But I think by the DVD release, it got scrapped, so it went back to Luke just being silent as he fell.
Yeah. Actually, it was in some DVD releases, but this would have been 2007 or 2008. I don't know. But yeah, I don't know if I've mentioned this before. I actually decided to make my own edits to the Star Wars trilogy.
Aren't there already a bunch of fan cuts out there already?
Some. What I did is I used the despecialized edition, which was taken from the Laserdisc footage. So that's how you have like really clear quality with the with unedited footage. And then I used that as a base to put back in the special edition changes that I thought worked. And this is gonna no doubt raise a few hairs. I put back Anakin's Force Ghost at the end of Return of the Jedi.
Why would that raise hairs? That just makes sense.
A lot of people I know who are very particular about the Star Wars special editions being dumb do not like Anakin's Force Ghost. Because Hayden Christensen looks creepy in it, or other similar things. My counterpoint is, when I first watched Return of the Jedi, and I saw the third Force Ghost, the one that just looks like an old dude, I'm like, who is that? Who's that supposed to be? I had no idea that it was Anakin.
Yeah, it goes to show, and you know what's interesting?
Lazy Gaming just commented, boo, unsubscribe.
I will say this though. Some of my favorite changes in the special editions were the ones that lined up with the canon. Because after prequels came out, I think around 2004 with DVD, starting DVD edition, Lucas started making changes to make it more in line with the prequels, so that way they form one cohesive narrative. Like, one of the biggest changes I would say is in episode 5, where they added in Ian McDiarmid in the scene with the Emperor.
Yes! Before they had to. I remember seeing that, and I'm like, I rewatched my unaltered versions of the Star Wars trilogy, because I actually have the VHS tapes still that came in the box set, and that was the last time the unaltered versions were ever released publicly. Immediately after I watched the special edition, and I'm like, wait a minute. The Emperor looks different in this scene. And then that made me realize, wow, some of the changes actually make sense.
Yeah. I would say this, though. I would argue the backlash against the special editions would be so bad if they did what Star Trek did, which is where they provide either the original edition or the altered version. But Lucas believes that the special editions are the only way people should see his movies, and so he does not release the original unaltered versions. In fact, the original Star Wars movie was pitched to be added to the Library of Congress, but George never submitted it because in order to do so, it has to be the original version of the movie, but that version has not been seen since it came in theaters in 1977.
Wait, seriously? There were changes made even to the home releases?
Yes, because when episode 4 came to VHS the very first time, they made one change to it. They had the phrase episode 4, A New Hope, in the opening crawl of the film. That was the only change they made. But because of that technically is not the original version.
In this case, I would argue Congress is being pedantic assholes. But yeah, the further changes, I could see why.
Yeah, and the funny thing, he wanted to call it episode 4 from the very beginning, but Fox was against it because there hadn't been a Star Wars movie before. So he had to leave it out when it came to theaters the first time. That's why it was just called Star Wars and nothing else.
Oh, that's right, because he didn't even know if he was going to be able to make the sequels. It's kind of funny to think about how Star Wars was originally an indie film when it was first coming out.
Yeah, and funny thing enough, his original Lucas's plan, and some people say like Lucas had like the perfect master plan, and like, no, that's not true. Anyone who knows Lucas knows that the Star Wars story has evolved and changed over the 40 years that he's worked, really the 30 years he's worked on it, because like, he has been around the last 15-ish years because of the Disney thing. But anyway, where was I? Yes. So, In the first 35 years of Star Wars, in the very beginning, the original plan was to do a quadrilogy of films. The first movie was supposed to be the prequel trilogy as one movie, and then the other three would be essentially the original trilogy. But then, when he pitched the idea, the producers were like, hey, this first movie seems a little bulky, why don't we go with part two because it's a simpler story? We can do that first and then do the others later if it does well. And so, after that, George actually had two versions of episode five. There's the version we all know and love, and then there's the other version called Splinter.
Right, the rough draft. That if I remember correctly, George got into like a serious argument with his co-producer when they were making that.
I don't know about that. What I do know is that Splinter of Mind's Eye was conceived as the idea of, would have been the sequel if episode 4 had flopped in the box office, because George fully intended on at least making a trilogy. And so if the first one had failed, he would just do a lower budget version for a sequel instead of like alternative plan. But because it did so well, he went with option A, which was Empire. Because that's the one he was going to do if it did well. Because it did well, we got Empire and then Return of the Jedi. And actually, another thing that changed was that Return of the Jedi was not supposed to be the last Star Wars film he made. The original plan, yep, he was actually going to do the sequel trilogy right after the originals. He was actually going to do multiple films following episode 5. But by the time
that explains the original ending plan for Jedi.
Yep. And the idea was Luke's sister was supposed to be a separate character. It was not going to be Leia. Luke would actually not meet the Emperor until episode 9, not episode 6. And there would have been a whole other set of movies set between Return of the Jedi leading up to that final confrontation. But Lucas got so burned out during the production of the third movie that they decided to just end on Return of the Jedi. And then he would go back and do more later if he had more ideas or maybe something else. Of course, he would go on to make the prequel trilogy, but even that was still an early development thing.
Right, and for those of you who heard me mention the original ending for Jedi and don't know what I'm talking about, the original plan was actually for the moon of Endor to be blown up by the second Death Star, Luke to take Vader's helmet and basically wander off into the horizon, so to speak. It was going to be a real soul-crushing ending.
And Han was supposed to die.
Yep. Harrison Ford would have gotten his wish. How many years early would that have been?
Way earlier. Interestingly enough, again, part of the reason that didn't happen was because Lucas canceled the other sequels, and B, he wanted to end the story in a happy ending so he could sell merchandise better, because he was worried if they do a dark ending for the third movie, they would hurt the merchandising. So he wanted a happy ending for his trilogy, and Norris didn't like that, and he left.
Yeah. Did you know the whole reason the Ewoks exist is because of an underestimate on what it would cost to make the costumes?
Or what, the Wookiees?
Yeah! The original plan was to have Endor be populated with Wookiees. But because of because they overestimated the cost of the material to make the costumes, they had to make them half as tall. So that's how we got the Ewoks.
That's right. And then we got two Ewok movies as well.
Wait, those were real? I thought that was the product of me eating cheese before bed.
No, they existed. They were like TV movies, so they weren't like theatrical releases, but yeah, they came on TV. One came out in 85, the other came out in 87, I believe. So they ran throughout the mid to late 80s.
Man, well, they were making movies of anything at that point.
They even made a cartoon with like C-3PO and R2 that also ran around the same time as those Ewok films.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Droids, yeah. I didn't watch the cartoon, but Droids and Droids Rebellion got adapted as comics, and those were in my grade school library, and I actually would occasionally read those from time to time. I remember liking Rebellion way better, Droids Rebellion way better than the regular Droids comic. Mostly, I think, if I remember correctly, it was the premise of Rebellion was the droids start overthrowing humanity, essentially, and C-3PO is somehow involved in all this. I think there was something like I think his personality got overwritten or something. But yeah, C-3PO basically turned into Bender from Futurama. It was hilarious.
Wow, I never heard of that comic.
Yeah, no, you gotta remember that this is a sequel comic to a failed TV show. It's not surprising that you haven't heard of it.
Oh yeah, of course. And funnily enough, I think it was actually decanonized long before the Disney deal, just because how popular it was.
Yeah, pretty much. That's why the Infinities continuity existed, which was basically just an umbrella for not just the what-if comics titled Infinities, but also media that just did not tie into the overall story.
Like the holiday special.
You know, the holiday special is notorious for being bad, and don't get me wrong, it is bad, but there are actually a small handful of good things in it, like the Boba Fett cartoon, and the song Goodnight But Not Goodbye. That's it. That's two things. That's all that's worth your time in that. And I think if I remember, like, Goodnight But Not Goodbye is about, like, your average writing for a song, like, 5 or so minutes. I think the Boba Fett animated cartoon is, like, 15 minutes. And that's, like, 20 minutes out of an entire hour-long thing.
Wow,
Sorry, what were you going to say?
No, I was surprised we got, so 30% is good and then the rest is trash.
More or less. I would say, and I remember when I saw the Nostalgia Critic post his review of it to YouTube, I'm like, oh man, this should be hilarious. Yes, Lazy Gaming, Wookiee Grandpa does in fact watch, yes. I was baffled by that when I saw that in Nostalgia Critic's review. I'm like, no, this is not happening.
You know what's even weirder? Originally that was supposed to be a more wholesome moment, where he got to relive his past memories of his old family and everything. And then some producers were like, oh, let's make this cool and edgy. And they did that.
What the fuck? Why? Who thought this was a good idea?
I don't know, watch SD6 at CBS. It was a brilliant idea.
Oh. That's really weird, because I vaguely remember CBS. Was it CBS? I don't know. There was a network I would turn on every Saturday when I was a kid, and watch cartoons on that wasn't Cartoon Network or Nickelodeon. That might have been ABC.
Yeah, because I have ABC Kids.
Yeah. But the fact that was changed like that, it's like, wow. I did not know about that. You know, if they had actually gone with the original path of having it a wholesome reliving his old memories, you know, that might have actually added another slight redeeming factor to the holiday special. But now, no, we got old man Wookiee watching internet videos that I can't mention in polite society. Oh man.
Okay, in defense of the holiday special, it came out in, like, Star Wars' infancy. This was well before the EU, well before it got really big and famous. I mean, the original movie wasn't called classic by that point, but this is before the rest of the original trilogy finished out, before all that stuff, so no one really knew what they were doing at the time. But I think nowadays, something like that would happen again.
Oh, hell no, it wouldn't. And it's probably for the best. There is actually one interesting bit of trivia about the holiday special. Did you know that holiday special actually has lore that's incorporated into the greater trilogy about why Luke looks different between Empire and the Return of the Jedi?
Really? How so?
If you pay attention during the holiday special when Luke is on screen, his lightsaber looks different. That lightsaber is actually... there is, like, really, really obscure lore that lightsaber was a failed attempt by Luke to build his own lightsaber, and it blew up in his face quite literally.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Wait, let me ask you this, though. Wasn't the holiday special take place before Empire, though?
No, it did. I'm probably getting my time. I'm probably, one, this is really obscure trivia, and two, I read this, like, what, back in 2018 or 2016, so the details are a bit hazy, but yeah.
Oh, so this was like an in-universe explanation.
It's really obscure. It's incredibly obscure, and I wish I could find it so I could post it in like the chat so we could so more people could see it. But yeah, the fact that there is lore for that is kind of baffling.
Yeah, I mean, we all know why Luke looks so different in real life. You know,
right? It's because of the car accident, and they had to redo his entire face. That must have been fucking hell to go through.
Oh man, he has not looked the same since. I think there's a reason why I saw show up on camera after 1983.
You know, it's interesting that you say that. I never know. I noticed a subtle difference as a kid. As an adult, I don't think this anymore. But I actually think when I was younger, I'm like, man, Luke's face looks like sculpted in episode 6. Well, come to find out, that's because it literally was. But I mean, I'm like, man, I wonder if my face will look that good when I'm growing up. That's what I thought to myself. Lo and behold, no.
It's a good thing you didn't turn out like that.
Yeah, probably not. I mean, plastic surgery cannot. If there's anything I've learned in life, it's that plastic surgery does not help, solve problems.
Oh, of course not. I mean, I remember this entire episode of the comment section where there was something about how like these young teenage girls were getting like all these surgeries to make themselves look better, because like a lot of them were like teenagers who were going through puberty, so a lot of them were trying to use plastic surgery to like fix their bodies. So like, but because of that, they were messing with like how they were growing up and stuff, how their bodies were changing. You know, during puberty, your body goes through changes and things like that. The Botox they were doing was basically messing with that.
You know, it's interesting that you bring that up, because, I mean, that's been a thing for, God, decades now. I remember that being a relevant topic when I was first becoming a teenager, maybe even slightly before that.
Really? I don't remember hearing about this when I was growing up. I think maybe, I don't know if it was relevant back then, but I think it's becoming more so now, because we're living in an age where, like, people are trying to match into these beauty standard. I know this might seem a little cliche, but there are people out there, you know, particularly young girls, who go online, they see all these like beautiful women, and they're trying to capture that look, but because they don't look exactly like that, they think that like they're ugly or something. But in reality, with many of those photos, even that's actually true of something back then, where people would like edit photos to make them look nicer in like magazines and stuff. Even today, that's still the case, but young girls don't know that. And so they think that they just look like that naturally, but like, more often the case, with stuff online, that's not the case.
You know, between that and all the other problems social media has caused for young people, sometimes I do wonder if the internet was a mistake.
I don't think the internet was a mistake. I think the smartphone is actually a bigger problem, because social media.
Smartphone is definitely a big is a big factor in it.
Yeah, because social media existed before the internet. Yeah, Facebook was a thing before the smartphone. YouTube was a thing before the smartphone. But I think after the smartphone came out, after everyone started getting a phone in the late 2000s and early 2010s, that's when a lot of the sort of ugly side of the internet really started to like pop up and change, arguably for the worse in many ways.
The internet and its consequences have been a disaster for the human race. Yeah, partly lazy, partly though I would argue that I like to meme about hating normies. I have occasionally shit posted in chat in other people's chats. Guess the normies meme war now, but in all honesty, it's not the normies that are the problem. It's people who aren't ready to have access to the internet. Having access are the problem. Also, Lazy says rest in peace, Uncle Ted. I wouldn't go that far. Ted was on to a few things, but I think people are overestimating how good his ideas were. There is a reason I slammed the Dark Age ending in Deus Ex for not solving the problem. I think that I didn't get my first smart device I actually didn't really discover the internet until I was well into my teens, probably 14 or 13 or 15 years old. I didn't get my first smartphone until I was like 16 or 17. And if I am fortunate enough to have kids, I will probably do the same for them. They will not be getting smartphones until they're well into their teens.
Yeah, I actually agree with that. I wouldn't even go as far as saying no smartphones until they're like fully mature adults, to be frank. Now, in my case, I got my first smartphone when I was like 15, 16. But the thing with me is that I didn't get social media until I went to college. Because even back then, I knew that, like, I've always felt it was a waste of time back then. I didn't want to get in it. So I just never got one. But not like kids had the foresight I did to realize that social media is a massive waste of time if you're not careful. That's certainly true of peers my generation when we went to school together. That's true of a lot of kids out there as well. In fact, I remember this tweet thread that Matt made a while back, Matt Walsh, where he said, "None of my kids have smartphones. The only people with screens are myself and my wife. We just have our phones, and I have my computer. The kids have no access to those devices. We just raise them outside." And that was it. And he got a lot of flack from people for not giving his kid a smartphone.
Why?
And people like, "Oh, how are you oppressing your kids? Why are you locking them away from the outside world? How are you so abusive?" I go, "What the fuck are you people smoking? Do you honestly
that believe is it. You took the words right out of my mouth there."
I'm like, "Do you people think that you have a human right to a smartphone? Are you kidding me right now?"
Yeah, I would not. It's my. We're just thinking about this from like a development angle, but my decision was more from the angle of like, you know, there's bad people out there on the internet. I don't talk about it nearly as much as the other shows that I watch, but I actually watched a shit ton of Law and Order, and I know that's not true to life. I know that, but I mean, there's some stuff to learn from that. It's like the world is not a perfect place. There are bad people out there who will do bad things, and the internet is a tool for them just as much as it is a tool for us. And we got to be careful out there.
Of course. Did you hear about what happened with Instagram?
Oh, yes. In fact, I actually might have heard about it before the news broke. I was given a recommendation of a press release done by a police officer or a police chief about a huge bust that they had done. And then, like, the next morning, that was when the news broke about Instagram.
Yeah, let's just say Meta needs to get their shit together, to put it lightly.
What, Meta?
Yeah, that's the company that owns Instagram. It used to be called Facebook, but they changed their name to Meta because they were going into the metaverse.
Lazy gaming, grew up with the rules of everyone online is a predator and never use your real name. What happened? I'll tell you what happened, Lazy. Social media happened. Facebook happened. Twitter happened. Reddit happened. MySpace happened.
Well, more so the smartphone happened and made all those sites worse. Oh, at least we forget. Oh, actually, let's not forget about Tumblr. Specifically the Tumblr X.
Oh, God. You know what? I get why Tumblr cracked down, it rightly so, but Tumblr was a containment site for those people. Now they're everywhere on the internet. Wait,
and they made everything worse.
Lazy says, "No, what happened with Instagram?" Okay, Rick, do you want to break it to him or should I?
I'll go ahead and do it. Basically, what happened was it turns out that a bunch of pedophiles were basically using Instagram to find and recruit young people to have sex with.
Yeah, and they were having. They also had. Were using Instagram to lead to off-site stuff that was even greasier. It was bad.
It was really bad. And it was so bad that, like, either somehow the people at Meta who were managing this stuff either missed this whole thing completely, or they knew and they just didn't care enough to stop it. And I find it interesting how stuff like this is going on while these companies are turning around trying to censor people or just saying things that hurt other people's feelings, even no matter how true it may be.
We have lost the... I say we. I really mean the people who are enforcing these policies. they have lost the plot when it comes to what should be moderated and what should be left free. They're spending all their time policing people for naughty opinions and bad words and completely overlooking the monsters at the gate.
Well, yeah, I would argue that, like, I know this might seem a bit cliche, but I would argue with the election of Donald Trump, they were so focused just owing that guy and eating the evil Republicans that they completely ignored not just the bad people on their own side, but the actual bad people out there who don't really care about this political stuff in the first place.
And, you know, this ties into what's going on with Biden. The FBI worked to suppress information about Hunter's laptop when it was relevant and the election was happening just because they didn't like Trump. And look, now we have, it's come out that not just Hunter, but Biden have done some really, really skeevy, corrupt shit.
I mean, are we surprised it's the same Biden who openly admitted to holding money from Ukraine unless they fired the guy who was investigating his son? And that was back when he was still the VP of the U.S.
Yeah. Although, I kind of wonder how much of... Well, I kind of wonder what the... who's pulling whose strings with the whole Biden and Ukraine situation. Because Biden is withholding aid, yeah, and his son was on the board of an energy company there. But it feels like Zelensky is also pulling a few strings. I wonder if he's got dirt on Biden or something.
I'm not really sure. I will say this, though. Hunter was clearly unqualified for that job that he had. There was no reason why a freaking meth head should be on a board of an energy company in a foreign country he's never even been to. Like, that makes zero sense.
Wasn't Hunter also fucking around with some Chinese girl, or was that someone else?
No, that was Eric Swalwell, and that was a Chinese spy he was screwing around with.
Oh, that's right. And if I'm not mistaken, that actually happened while he was he mayor at the time?
No, this happened recently while he was a member of the House.
Oh, shit. Okay, that's bad.
Yeah, fairly recent. Surprisingly, nobody's talking about that. Instead, we're focusing on, like, a couple papers that Trump had in his bathroom.
Wait, Lazy, has that been proven? I had heard rumors that Hunter was fucking around with girls that he shouldn't be, who were underage, but I didn't, obviously, no proof.
Yeah, let's be careful about that, because like, Biden's been accused of being a P-word too, but like, some of those claims are a bit iffy, and I'm not really comfortable just throwing stuff around unless we know definitively, like, one way or the other. So with stuff like that, we just tend to keep it at arm's length. We don't want to amplify things that are false, after all.
Right.
And like I said, even if someone you don't disagree with, it's very important to try to be as truthful as possible first and foremost. You know, just because you don't like somebody doesn't mean you have the right to lie about them.
Yeah. You know, it's kind of... I'm really, really hoping that 2024... At this point, I care less about Trump getting back into office and more about Biden getting removed from it. This country is being run into the fucking ground by Biden and... Or, no, not Biden. His handlers. Because you know that senile old bastard is not calling the shots. I honestly feel bad for him.
Nah, he's basically just a puppet of the elites at this point. They're just using him to try and push the stuff they really want to see and make it look all peachy clean.
Yeah. You know, I don't know, we kind of devolved into politics, but fuck it, might as well go full tilt. You know, this morning I was actually watching a video on how how young people are quiet quitting at their job, and that just means, like, doing your 9-to-5 and going no further. And part of this is the guy who was going over the phenomenon said that part of this might be stemming from the fact that the Federal Reserve is taking away people's ability to provide for themselves and their families, making the currency continually worthless by printing more and more of it, and how this has also affected the cost of housing, because with the more money that circulates in U.S. economy is directly parallel to the climb in the price of housing. I knew that the two were symbiotic. I didn't know there was a direct link between the two. That's fucking bonkers.
Yeah, I think a lot of people tend to focus a lot on the culture, political stuff, but not a lot of people talk about the economic stuff. And I think the only time I feel like economics was really at the forefront was at the 2008 financial crisis. That I think was the one time like whoever wants to concern was concerned about the money and things. Like, I feel like nowadays a lot of things push to like the waste side in favor of other stuff. And I think if you ignore economics, that's not very good for the country, really, for anyone, really.
The problem is there will never be proof, and with all the scandal surrounding the island and everyone who went to it, it's safe. Yeah, unfortunately, you are actually dead on with that one. It's maddening to know that Ghislaine Maxwell is the first person to be criminally charged with nothing. They threw the book at her, don't get me wrong, but we aren't getting that client list, and there's a reason for it. I suppose this is. I suppose the only solace we really can take is that nobody escapes justice the other side of eternity.
Yep, we've talked about that a lot on our. We actually a couple times on our other podcast, but yeah, that's kind of the grace about walking the path that we do. Is that we know that, like, no matter what happens here, ultimately, goodness will prevail.
They all know each other, they all travel in the same circles, so they all know and protect each other. Yeah, you know, it kind of makes me wonder how long we have till one of two things happens. Either A, we get civil war, or B, a coup d'etat happens. Because eventually the naked corruption, the thing about naked corruption like that is that it is not sustainable. It has to cave at some point. It's not a question of if, but when. Unless the problem gets sorted out by the people that are on the edge of that, like not directly involved but know about it. But unfortunately, we don't know what the likelihood of that happening is. It's not a pretty thought.
I have a bit of, I don't know if this is a hot take or not, but I don't think we'll see a civil war in our lifetimes, or really a World War III in our lifetimes for that matter.
I certainly hope you're right.
And the reason I say this is because, you know what's funny? I think Matt Walsh talked about this a couple of years ago, actually. It was back when I used to read his articles on the Daily Wire. He made a point where, like, the reason why a war is not going to happen in our lifetime is because too many people in this country don't know how to fight. Nobody has fought. Most people have not fired a gun. Most do not have practical combat experience. So even if someone were to try to start a war, like, there wouldn't be any soldiers to fight it.
My counterpoint to that is that it only took 3% of the population to oust the British.
Yeah, but that 3% back then were people who were willing to fight, willing to do that. How many people today are willing to actually fight and die for their beliefs if a war were to come? Very, very few would actually imagine, especially when push comes to shove.
Well, not necessarily. There is probably a good number who are and just are smart enough to not openly say it.
Maybe. But then again, right now the guns are on our side, so I don't really know how that would go.
Lazy's got a humorous, but unfortunately true take. Not a hot take. Nothing is going to happen while there's cheap food and TV. I mean, yeah, you're right about that, but we're getting to the point where there might not be food or TV with how bad things are getting. If people can't provide for themselves, that's going to make a lot of people really pissed off really fast. Look how long the Roman Empire lasted despite the naked corruption bred in circuses. Yeah, but we're not quite the same as the Roman Empire, or Republic for that matter.
Well, here's the thing, though. Yeah, keep in mind, with the British, they've been around for over a millennia in various shapes and forms. They technically have never really collapsed. Like, they've grown and shrunk over the years, but they never went extinct the way the Romans did. And they outlived the Romans by several centuries.
Right, and the U.S. is younger than Britain by a good amount of time. What was the cycle again? Empires tend to last, 250 years or something like that?
roughly speaking, give or take. I guess it depends on or not you consider America to be an empire. I certainly don't think that, but some people do.
Well, we're in a weird place, because America's foreign policy, it acts like an empire. We have not been shy about ousting people because they weren't willing to play ball with us, and that is very much an imperial trait. Our domestic policies are more akin to a republic, a republic in stagnation and growing ever more corrupt, but a republic nonetheless.
Hmm.
I suspect that what will likely happen is if shit gets really bad, we might see a figure try to, totalitarian figure take over and turn America into a dictatorship or a full-blown empire. Whether or not that is to restore a republic or just morph the country into something new is yet to be seen. Though in all likelihood, it would stay an empire longer than it would become a republic again. I think the saving grace for the U.S. was its distance from the seat of power and the ideal of the yeoman farmer? I'm not familiar with that. What's the yeoman farmer?
Sounds familiar, but I can't remember off the top of my head.
Yep, time for Google. Or Brave, I guess, because I don't use Google anymore. Google glows in the dark.
Here.
Yeoman, a member of a social class in England and the United States. Noun originally referring either to one who owns and cultivates land or to the middle ranks of servants in an English royal or noble household. The term was first documented in mid-14th century England. And, yeah, no, the rest is just... wait, hold up. The 14th century also witnessed the rise of the yeoman longbow. Archer during Hundred Years' War and the yeoman outlaws celebrated in Robin Hood ballads. Oh, okay, so this is where we get Robin Hood from. That's kind of cool.
Neat.
Yeah. Actually, Robin Hood was one of my favorite stories as a kid. If I wasn't reading the King Arthur books that were age appropriate, I was reading Robin Hood ones. And I forget. Have you read Atlas Shrugged, Rick, or are you still working on that one?
I have not gone around to it just yet. I own the book, but I haven't read it yet.
Right. I know when you first got it, we were joking about how thick that bitch was.
Yeah, I have not seen a book that thick since Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire.
See, I think the thickest book I own, at least physically, is my study Bible. That thing is huge. Atlas Shrugged is like roughly the size of the entire Lord of the Rings trilogy, and then half that added onto it. But there is a character in Atlas Shrugged that is a pirate attacking ships sending out foreign aid. And essentially, what happens is someone asks him about why he's doing this, his motives, and he wants to undermine the legacy of Robin Hood, essentially. And the reason for this is interesting, because the pirate who's been attacking the ship says that Robin Hood's legacy is being used to justify taking money from poor people and redistributing it through taxes. And I'm like, you know what? Robin Hood was understood that governments should not be like crushing people with crippling taxes. But the more I think about it, a lot of modern socialists do make that analogy, and it's like, yeah, they kind of missed the point there.
Yep, and here's the funny part. Because some people like to say Robin's about like, oh, you know, stealing from the rich and giving to the poor. No, he wasn't just stealing from rich people giving that money to poor people. He was taking money from tax collectors and giving it back to people who were wrongfully taxed.
Yes, exactly.
That's why Robin Hood was a hero. Because if he was just a guy who stole, he'd just be a petty thief. But because he was... So it really wasn't stealing away, he was taking back what was rightfully other people's stuff. On their behalf, no less. And it's no coincidence that the Socialists are getting this story wrong, because they believe that the state should control everything.
Yeah, or they're just brainlets. I was one of the brainlet ones when I was younger.
I thought you actually, were the, well, I thought you were the desperate ones.
Well, a bit of both. But yeah, no, I've said before, there's three types of socialists. There's the desperate, there's the ideologues, and there's the idiots.
So where do you think the Twitch streamer socialists fall under?
I don't know. I don't watch them.
Fair enough.
Now, BreadTube, on the other hand, I've had enough exposure to secondhand that I would know that most of them are... They're opportunists. They are shitheads. They are the kind of people who own, like, multi-thousand dollar cars and are whining about capitalism. There was a bank robber at the turn of the century that would burn the loan documents of the banks he robbed. Yeah, I know who you're talking about. Oh, I think he showed up on a Count Dankula Mad Lads video. It might have... Oh, no, it was the Australian one. Chopper. No, that wasn't him. Ned Kelly. That's who it was.
Who?
Ned Kelly was an Australian outlaw who from early adolescence into adulthood, he was just fucked over by the system and lived the life of an outlaw. And because he was so thoroughly fucked over by the government, he kind of he became an anti-authority figure. He would go on bank heists, but he would do things like burning the burning loan documents and mortgage foreclosure documents and shit like that when he would knock over a bank. I think his end goal might have actually been to start some sort of uprising, because he actually wrote a manifesto that more or less was directed at the government with the thesis of respect my authority.
Sounds like a certain koala that you and I might know.
I don't know who you're referring to, so you probably know them better than I do.
Oh, remember? Okay, let me ask you this. Remember that guy Mike used to hang out with? He would help to promote his book?
You're going to have to be a bit more specific than that.
Okay, do you remember a book called Xenotype?
No, I don't.
Really?
I've only been paying attention to Three Knights and Inglewood and Project Lazarus.
Really? Because Mike is hanging with this dude all the time during, like, the early, like, CG days when he was... while Three Knights is being promoted, I believe. Ah, man, you know what's funny? I forgot his name, too. All I remember was that he was Australian. That was basically it. They were talking about him on the server just a few days ago. What name was his name?
Yeah, unfortunately, I probably wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, that's fine. You know what? My dad always said if you can't remember something, it probably wasn't important, so I'm not even going to dwell on it. To be frank, he's not. What I do know is that he's not worth the attention anyways. He's just the kind of person who just does stuff just to get attention. And you know what? I'm not going to feed into that.
Oh, he's one of those people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's funny that you bring that up. Lazy Gaming, you aren't on the Discord server yet. I might post a link on Twitter later, so look out for that. Rick, I know you are. I don't know if you saw the meme dump after my brother joined. I had to go in there and sterilize that place. Oh. My brother was posting his Reich garbage.
Oh, yeah. I did see a lot of posting on the server when he showed up. I wasn't really sure what was there. I saw a bunch of pictures. It just kind of moved on my day.
Yeah, because we are a good Christian server, and I don't want people to get the wrong idea, I had to go and sterilize my brother's Reich posting. Some of the stuff I kept because I'm like, okay, I gotta give my brother some leeway, otherwise he's just gonna do it more. You know how it goes. Give someone an acceptable bounds, they'll stay within. But there was some pretty bad vulgar stuff in there. So I saw that. I'm like, oh, damn it, Sam. I love my brother. I think he's hilarious. And I pray to God that he's doing this shit to get attention or to shock people. But the amount of memorabilia I've seen in his room at his house, it makes me wonder.
Oh, yeah.
The problem is my brother is genuinely funny and really good at shock humor. It's like, you know, you shouldn't be laughing, but you are anyway. Kind of, I actually was on, when I was talking with my dad, what was it, some weekends ago, we got to talking about my grandfather and the time I and my brother would go and visit him and my grandma. And this is a story that my granddad recalls that I can't remember, that I only vaguely remember. We were going to a store, I think it was the butcher shop, and one of us, me or my brother, started shit, and the other finished it. Landed a punch on the shoulder or something like that. And my grandfather broke up the fight and profusely apologized for us starting a brawl in the butcher's shop. And the butcher was really cool about it. He's like, ah, you know, sometimes you just gotta hit your brother. And my granddad did not approve of that reply. But I vaguely remember me and my brother both being very, very glad that the butcher wasn't too annoyed with us, because that probably saved us from a sterner talking to from our grandfather. Well, get ready for esoteric Hyperborea memes. Oh, Lazy, you and my brother are going to get along great, I think. My brother likes the esoteric memes as well. He's occasionally gone on the odd rant about Agartha or stuff like that.
What's an esoteric thing again?
Esoteric is a term for something that is not quite occult, but not quite normal phenomena either. It's basically used as a catch-all term for things that aren't quite occult, but aren't quite normal either.
Did you just say that?
I guess I did.
I feel like you said the same thing twice.
Sometimes when I'm trying to explain something that I don't have a good grasp on, I will repeat myself accidentally.
Understandable.
Secret hidden knowledge. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Basically, anything that is obscure would be considered esoteric.
Kind of like lost episodes of a TV show you know and love.
Yes, exactly. Iceberg charts towards the bottom tend to get very esoteric. Man, I freaking love iceberg charts. I find it funny how people used to talk shit about YouTube top 10 list videos back when those were still around, but now we've kind of come full circle and everyone's doing iceberg charts on anything.
Yeah, there's always a trend. I think the top 10 thing was still a trend for the time, and I know because I used to subscribe to a YouTube channel where all they would do is, like, top 10 everything. Is that just saying
you... Oh, yeah, no, I was subscribed to a good number of those as well.
Yeah,
One of my favorite YouTube channels that sadly doesn't really make new videos anymore, or if they do, they're very, very far and few between. Tat's Top 10s, if anyone else is familiar with that.
Actually, have you ever heard of a channel called All Time 10s?
Probably.
Well, they did their channel called All Kind Conspiracies, and that's where they deal with those different conspiracy theories, like online. Back.
Yes, I actually was subscribed to that one.
Really? I was too?
Oh, cool!
Yeah, because this was back when conspiracy theories were just conspiracy theorists, and they weren't all, like, coming true, and the media was just denying it, you know? This is back when you could have a conspiracy theory, and people could just laugh out saying, yeah, that's silly, that never happened. Man, I miss those days. Because I feel like nowadays, whenever someone says a conspiracy theory, you can't take it seriously anymore because there's a good chance it could be true.
Right. Lazy Gaming says in the chat, occult can be esoteric but has more of a metaphysical nature. And then he also says All Time is great. Hey,
All Time was the best, man. I miss those guys. I wonder what they're doing now.
Yeah, who knows? You know what makes me bummed out about conspiracy theories being so... so prevalent now, is that is the reason we will never get a remake of the original Deus Ex. The creator of the game himself has come out and said that he made Deus Ex when conspiracy theories were considered like an oddity that is like interesting to think about, whereas now they've become like widely believed by a lot of people, or are so or really depressing ones turn out to be completely true.
Oh no, this sucks.
It's more or less been confirmed we are never getting a remake of the original Deus Ex.
It's a bummer. You know what else is a bummer, though? All Time 10 does not launch a video in 4 months. Our last video was 4 months ago. I went to the All Time Conspiracy channel, which is now called Uncover. The entire channel is cleared out. There's nothing left. All the videos
Susan hit them with the ban hammer.
I guess so.
He's still up. He has a couple of different channels all under the all-time name. Oh, so apparently they're still making content.
I guess, but like, all-time gaming is gone too. Unless there's some new channels I don't know about, but... All-time. Oh man, all-time's gone too. What the heck? Weird. Yeah, I guess things must have changed. I've been in this channel in like 6 years, so things have definitely changed, but man, this is very strange.
Yeah, I think the last time I watched All Time's content was back in like 2016.
Yeah, that's around the time I was. I think I dropped around the time I left high school, because like, I was getting bored of like the top 10 stuff, and I just moved on to other things. Who knows, maybe he's doing those iceberg videos now.
Yeah, in all likelihood.
All-time icebergs.
You know, this talk of conspiracy theories and iceberg charts, you ever seen the conspiracy theory iceberg videos put out by Windigoon?
No, I have not.
Oh, you know, you'd probably like it. Windigoon is a guy who, when he does iceberg videos, he actually does, like, in-depth research on each of the topics. I think his conspiracy theory iceberg was like 9 videos long, and each one was about an hour. Whoa. So if you've got a day to kill, or if you want to like listen to something as you're doing other stuff, that's I cannot recommend that enough. I do wish he'd go into he'd do the deeper dive video on the Denver airport. Some of the ones that he had talked about, he did videos where he was analyzing them even more in depth, like Gnosticism. Or, oh god, what was the other one?
What about the Denver airport?
But he said he was going to do the Denver airport, and then he never did, which is incredibly frustrating, because the Denver airport is fascinating. That entire building is weird. They had a perfectly good airport, and then they decide they're going to build a new airport, and then they just add all this extra weird shit to it. There's a statue of a man on a horse outside named Blucifer. No joke, that's the actual name of the art piece. There's weird murals of a dude wearing a gas mask holding a scimitar, pointed at a little girl holding a flower inside. It's bizarre. There's supposedly, like, extra basement levels that aren't on the documented blueprints of the building. I would kill for a Windigoon video on the Denver airport.
So, is that a working airport, or is that closed?
I have no idea.
That's very weird. I gotta look into this.
Yeah, it's a complete anomaly. I have no idea if that airport is functioning, because I have never had reason to fly to Denver. I've only ever been to Chicago, Wisconsin, California, and Florida.
Is it called the Denver International Airport, or is that a different one?
That's the one. Oh, it's open! So it's got people going through it.
Yeah, and they have an official website and everything.
Wow.
A part of me wants to fly to Denver just to see what's in the airport now.
I know, right? Me too. Dude, imagine if that's how we met. Imagine if we both just decided to show up at the Denver airport on the same day.
Yeah, we could do a dual trip to, like, Colorado and just meet up at the airport.
Denver airport conspiracy live stream!
Yo! Let's go!
I gotta buy myself a blue trench coat and some sunglasses, so that way I can dress like J.C. Denton. I mean, if we're going full conspiracy theory, might as well look the part.
I know, right? Although I feel like we want
the horse statue killed the artist. Holy shit! I didn't know about that detail.
What?
Yeah, Lazy Gaming here says the horse statue killed the artist. I'm looking that up. Apparently, when they were installing it, it fell and crushed him.
Oh, that's probably... Okay, that makes a little more sense.
Yeah. Still, that is a weird coincidence.
That is very weird.
We've been at this now for about an hour and a half.
Oh my god, there's a New York Times article on the whole subject. And there's a picture of Lucifer on the cover.
Okay, I've got to find this thing now.
Oh, his official name is actually Mustang, actually. Not Lucifer. Oh, that's actually the unofficial name. Of course there's a paywall in this damn thing, because why wouldn't there be?
Ah, that's lame. Yeah, we've been at this for an hour and 35 now. Do you want to just call it here?
Yeah, let's call it.
All right, it has been fun, though.
Oh, it's been a blast. We talked so much stuff, went all over the place. It was great.
Awesome. I'll be looking forward to seeing you again on Tuesday when we do the Dragon Quest stream.
Oh, that's going to be fun. Can't wait for it.
Yep. Oh, one other thing. Do you want to do Tuesdays and Wednesdays, or do you just want to do Tuesdays? Because RPGs are pretty long, and I don't know how long you can stay up since we're starting at 9 p.m. your time.
You know, I'm actually thinking... No, not be good, because I was thinking maybe we could start at 8, but I also need, like, 10 showers and stuff. So, you know what, how about we do Tuesday and Wednesdays for now? Because I could do maybe, you know, it is 9 p.m., so maybe, like, 2-3 hours a day, maybe? Because by that point, the only other thing I have to do... Yeah, because by that point, I should be done with everything else by that time, so I should dedicate it
awesome.
There. And, yeah, I think that'd be good. You know, maybe we should announce this plans over a stream.
Yeah, I'll post it on the Discord server as well.
Don't worry.
Yeah,
and for those watching, we'll keep you up to date with all the changes, so don't worry about, like, random stuff on here.
Yeah, right. The cool thing is you're the only one with a schedule that isn't completely open, so everyone else's time can be flexible around yours.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So right now it's looking like we do Tuesdays and Wednesday nights, 3-hour Dragon Quest stream each day.
Oh, sounds fun.
Yeah. I'm gonna end the call here and end the recording, and then I am gonna eat something because I went to go grab food, and then I realized, wait, no, I don't have enough time to boil the water to make hot dogs.
But you couldn't have
all right.
Out. Anyway, let's head out. I'm glad I had fun. Thanks for watching, everyone. Hope y'all have a great week.
Good night. Oh. Okay, well...